Worship, as one of our former pastors, Dr. Wisnett, said, Welcome to another beautiful Sunday at the Margate Community Church. We are delighted to see all of you here. We especially want to welcome any visitors that are with us this morning. We always expect visitors. And so please make yourself known to me when I stand at the back of the church later. And we also ask members and visitors to sign the friendship registers that are found in the pews. And then if you would pass it over, if there's anyone else in your pew, we will see with whom we are worshiping this morning. We have a couple of things for today. Coffee hour, of course, after church. I understand there's some Chester's goodies there, so you may want to make your way back. And also, there's a Christian Ed meeting after church. Our Sunday school teachers will be planning for Rally Day, blessing of the backpacks, and for our fall season of Sunday school. On Tuesday and Thursday this week, we have scholarship interviews. Thus far, we have seven applicants for our scholarships, and so they will be interviewed from 3 to 7 on both of those days. By now, I am sure that you heard that we had to postpone our Godspell weekend, our Friday, Saturday, Sunday shows. Two of the cast members had COVID, and so we just postponed it a week. So if you had planned on coming this past Friday, you may come this Friday. I'm not sure if you need to call again for reservations, but it probably wouldn't hurt. But we're looking forward to it. The show is wonderful. Richard and I saw it last Friday, a week ago, and we can recommend it. It's a great show. Also, I'm not sure how this happened because it involves me, but we have been nominated for Best of the Press. Best place of worship, and for me, as the best wedding officiant. And so today is the last day that you can vote us into the next level. You know, this doesn't give us the title, but it gives us, like, the finals. And so if you would go online at Best of the Press, you will find it there. And if you can nominate us, the church and me, please, that we would really appreciate it. We'll see where it goes, but it's just kind of fun to even get into the nomination group. As most of you know, our craft show on August the 13th is coming up quickly. George needs quite a bit of help, and so he's already started things, but there are sign-up sheets in Fellowship Hall for specific times that you can come and help, because this is an all-hands-on-deck kind of event, and we really need all the help that we can get. Next Sunday is Communion Sunday, so we hope that you will be here so that we can celebrate the Lord's Supper together. And today is very special because we are going to welcome some new members into our congregation. So new members, you know who you are. If you'll come up, George and I will welcome you into our congregation. The Gooden family is not here. I didn't hear from Mom and Dad, but I knew that Steve Gooden Jr. couldn't be here because he's on the beach patrol. So he's doing his job as a lifeguard. But we are delighted that you are here. And this is Dick Frank. We have loved seeing Dick around all the time. He's always with Karen, and so we are delighted that you are making it official. This is Judy Fiacco. She actually is an ordained UCC minister, and so we are delighted that you are part of our congregation. And this is Lisa Gamash. Some of you may remember Lisa from a while ago. She needed to move away for a while to take care of family, but she's back. So we are delighted to have all of you here. And I have two questions to ask the new members. One, is Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior? And will you use your time, talents, and treasures to the best of your ability with this church? Yes? Very good. And so we can welcome you.
What we'd like to do together with our new members is recite the covenant of the Margate Community Church. It's insert or on the back of the hymnal. We, a free people of the Lord, joyfully covenant with God and with one another, as an ecumenical congregation, walk together in all God's ways, made known to
And so, we would like to welcome you into the church, and we have some gift bags for you.
I'll pull the tag off.
Thank you, and may God bless you as you're part of our church family. We are delighted that you're here, and we all want to work together. Amen. Wait a second. The Goodens are here. Come on up.
I didn't miss anything.
We're going to read that covenant again, so help me. You did read the covenant? Okay, well, come up so you can be recognized here.
Thank you.
This is Steve Gooden Sr. and Michelle Gooden, and we are delighted that they are officially becoming part of the congregation. They've been here in the congregation quite a bit. Their younger son was in my confirmation class a couple of years ago, and it's confirmed, so he's been a member, so I'm glad to have them as the members as well. And so welcome to our church. Thanks, you made it. Let us begin our worship by listening to the introit.
This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground. For the Lord is present, and where he is holy. This is holy.
Call to worship. We are the community of faith that has been created by the love of God.
We are people who have been set free by the word of forgiveness in Jesus Christ.
We have not come to show our own goodness, but to praise the holiness of God.
We have not come to boast of what we have done, but to proclaim the redeeming work of Jesus Christ.
Let us tell of God's kindness towards us. With all our being, we will praise God. Let us worship God together. We will now sing hymn number 149, verses 1, 2, and 3. Excuse me, 145.
Like the first dew fall on the first rain. is the sun, love. Mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden saw plain. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation.
Please be seated.
Loving God, you always hold us so gently. Teach us the art of letting go of things that keep us from your embrace. We grab and clutch things that will be out of style or useless as time goes by. We go after success and recognition as if they will fill our deepest longings. We saddle relationships with unrealistic and unfair expectations. Loving God, lead us to a deeper sense of gratitude and a growing sense of trust in your ability to provide for us. Teach us what treasures will truly last. Show us the blessings of giving with joy, loving without conditions, and sharing from our abundance. We ask all of this in Jesus' name.
And our scripture lesson this morning comes from the Psalms. I think you will recognize part of this psalm, and this is Psalm 118. So listen for God's word to you this morning. Open for me the gates where the righteous enter, and I will go in and thank the Lord. These gates lead to the presence of the Lord, and the godly enter there. I thank you for answering my prayer and giving me victory. The stone that the builders rejected has now become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is wonderful to see. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Will you pray with me? O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I want to start with a couple of questions this morning. Do you make every day count for something? Do you celebrate life? Do you think you are really living life to the fullest? Do you see each day as a special gift from God, exhilarating, exciting, packed with new opportunities and possibilities? Or do you feel as though life is passing you by and running you down? Sadly, it's documented that a lot of people feel that way, very unhappy and unfulfilled in the moment. They're so caught up in looking for another day that they miss the joy and meaning of this day. For some people, the good days are in the past. Of course, we all know that the good days were not the good old days. They're not as good as we remember them to be. And other people long for the future. It'll be great when, it'll be great if, waiting for the future. And still others are harried and frustrated and depleted by the busyness of packing every day full of activities and things to do. Well, I'm suggesting this morning that all of these people, those who live in the past, those who think life will be better one day, and the worn out ones, are all missing life. They're really not living. They're just coping, surviving, hanging in there, not really celebrating life. So let's be honest this morning. How is it for you? Are you really living, or do you feel like everything is just whirling past you and passing you by? I'm sure I don't have to tell you that life is a wonderful gift, but without question, it can be downright hard and challenging at times. And because of that, sometimes we give in to the blahs. After what we've been through this last 2.5 years and still going on, it's pretty easy to feel depressed and bummed out or gloomy. Actually, looking at food prices and gasoline prices and our portfolios can make it very gloomy. But that's not the only way that we get these down feelings. Sometimes they come because of a harsh word from a boss, or a ticket, or a dent in the fender, or a misunderstanding with someone, or a problem with a child or grandchild. Sometimes feeling like we disappointed someone. If we feel like we're getting cold symptoms, oh Lord, please don't let it be COVID. Feeling that we've just not done our best and there's no use trying any harder. Or even something really serious, like a very serious illness or the loss of a loved one. All of these things, and so many more, can cause us to feel gloomy or depressed. Modern medicine spends a lot of time and energy and dollars trying to fix us. But even with all of this effective help and resources, a lot of people still turn to alcohol to drown it, or for drugs to escape the problems. The blues will descend on us from time to time, no doubt. And there are a couple of simplistic solutions that I can give you this morning, very simplistic, like taking a walk outside, taking a walk on the beach, feeling the warmth of sunshine, breathing in some fresh air, watching a little child for a while, well, a happy one at least, not one that's crying at that moment. And really what I'm trying to say is that we need to take advantage of the miracles of God's wonderful creation and remember that the one who made all of it, who put the cosmos in place, loves us with an unconditional love. Appreciate that, celebrate that, and glow in the gorgeousness of creation. We can think about a man named Orville Kelly. You wouldn't know this guy. He was written about in a book a long time ago by Dr. Norman Vincent Peale. The book was called The Positive Principle Today. It seems that Orville, age 42, went to a doctor for a regular medical visit and found out that he had cancer. After a few more tests, he found out that it was inoperable cancer and he had approximately a year to live. He was stunned, and so was his wife, Wanda. Orville and Wanda decided not to tell their 4 young children, but the tension in the house was absolutely palatable. You could have an elephant, you know, that proverbial elephant in every single room in the house. Friends gave them terrible advice, like, try not to think about it. Sure. Sure. That's almost like the rotten advice Job got in the Bible. Wanda and Orville wanted to say comforting and loving things to each other, but they were afraid it would upset the other person, so they said nothing. When they went to the chemo treatment center, the cancer center, those were very long, silent car rides. Finally, Orville said one day, look, I'm going to die from cancer, but I'm not dead yet. So let's start enjoying life again. Orville suggested that they go home and throw a big barbecue, inviting a lot of friends and their relatives. They told their children the truth about his condition and started living again. He didn't want to waste even one more day thinking about death only. He wanted to make that day count. He said, each day, I am not just a day closer to death. I have another day of life. I accept each day as a gift from God to be appreciated, enjoyed, and lived to the fullest. And he decided to form a program called MTC, Make Today Count. After all, Orville said, we are all terminal in some sense. I don't need to tell you, none of us get out of this life alive. His terminal date, though, was just more clearly determined. But none of us knows what each day will bring. Orville chose to see every single day as a special and gracious gift from God. He knew he was facing death, but actually he became more alive by making every day count. And isn't this exactly what the psalmist is trying to say in our scripture passage? This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Those two sentences from Psalm 118 have been used for centuries at the beginning of wonderful worship services, but they are also practical and dynamic words for living life. I believe that if we could say those words and really mean it every day when we got out of bed, it would change our lives. This is the day the Lord has given me, and it is a gracious gift. I will rejoice and be glad in it and be thankful for it. I saw a bumper sticker a long time ago that said it very well. Today is God's gift to us. That's why we call it the present. Today is God's day. God has given it to us, and we should see it as a special gift and make it count. To do the opposite almost seems sinful and destructive, doesn't it? So how can we do this? How can we make every day count? Well, as you probably guessed, I have a few suggestions. First, we can make it count by saying, I will be aware. I will be sensitive to what is happening around me. Some people call it being mindful. I'll pay attention to what I'm seeing, hearing, and feeling. To be perfectly honest, some days I feel like I'm just running willy-nilly around the hundreds of things I need to do. And let me ask you this question. How many of you misplace things? Like your key, me too, glasses, keys. Oh my gosh, keys are the worst, I think. And wallets, in our house, a wallet is one of the big deals. But, you know, I take my glasses off to read when I'm in the office. And then I do a bunch of things, and I may even walk out of the office and come back. Do you think I can find my keys? My glasses. Carmela will tell you that I've had her look for my glasses in the office because I wasn't thinking when I put my glasses down. And part of the reason that we do these things is that we're not noticing. Slowing down will help. And trust me, I know that's not always easy to do. I think of this phrase, though. Jesus was always busy. If you read scripture, you can see that he's always busy, but he was never hurried. Interesting point. Slowing down and being mindful might help us to know what is really going on around us. And part of mindfulness is being sensitive to the wonders and challenges of God's world. To be honest, we have so many things that hit our senses these days. We have the internet, the Facebook, the tweets, the emails, the advertisements, political opinions, breaking news, commercial products, all looking for our attention, our loyalty, and our dollars. We're pushed and pulled in so many directions. It's almost like we have to shut down in self-defense. But if we do that, then we walk around like a bunch of zombies, moving through life unfeeling, uninspired, and unaware. Some time ago, I was browsing through a magazine and I found a little questionnaire. It was really a simple one. It was about our basic senses. It was the awareness test that said this. What were the last five sounds you heard? The last five sights you saw? The last five surfaces you touched? The last five fragrances you smelled? The last five things you tasted? I have to tell you, I had a lot of trouble with that test. Honestly, I could only remember a couple of things in each category. So what about you? How would you do with that test right now? After I failed that test so miserably, I went outside and tried to notice things deliberately, to try to take it all in, and it was wonderful. I remembered the psalm, really. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And I realized with shame that I hadn't been doing that. So I asked God to forgive me and to make me more aware. And besides saying this psalm at the beginning of each day, we might want to add the words, Lord, make me aware today. Give me eyes of faith. And secondly, we can make each day count by saying, today I will do something for someone else. I will not be just thinking of myself today. I will reach out to somebody else. And to tell you the truth, the key to happiness is helping others and thinking about other people. I read a little story about a man who was in church praying so hard for his sick friend. He said, he was on his knees. He said, please, Lord, please help my friend. Help him now before it's too late. Touch him, Lord, even if it's with your little finger. And then a little voice inside his head said, why don't you touch your friend? You touch him. You are my finger. Now, I think you've heard me say this on similar occasions. We are God's hands and arms in this world. Sometimes we're God's words here on earth. God touches others through us. And one of the ways we as Christians can make each day count is by reaching out and touching others in the Spirit of Christ. And lastly, we can make each day count if by saying, today I will trust God for tomorrow. These days, more than ever, I think it's so easy to be frightened by the future, nervous about the unknown, anxious about what lies ahead. And this is where I call our faith rubber hits the road. Our faith is given to us as a gift to get us through these valleys and shadows and fears that each one of us have. But we have the assurance, we have God's own promise that God is with us and that we can count on God and trust God. We may not know what the future holds, but we know who holds the future. Whatever happens, come what may, God will be there for us. So we do our best and we trust God for the rest. Now, I don't own this book, but I've heard about it. And this is the title, Why Jesus Never Had Ulcers. It was written by a Methodist minister named Robert Holmes. I haven't read it, but I did read the synopsis of it. He pointed out that Jesus never had ulcers because he remembered his priorities, what was truly important. He remembered his calling to speak the truth in love and not worry about success. He remembered who was really in charge. He remembered to be in touch with God regularly. And he remembered to do his best today and to trust God with every day, all the way through eternity. That's what it's about, isn't it? That's how we make each day count. Today, I will be aware. Today, I will reach out and help someone else. Today, I will trust God for tomorrow. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen.
Please join me in the affirmation of faith found in your bulletin. We believe in God, our source of hope, which though fragile and often dashed, is surprisingly strong and resilient. We believe that hope is given so that we can wake each morning with a sense of wonder and live each day in the light of joy that is promised. We believe that hope is woven with faith and love to form a tapestry of beauty and possibility. We believe that out of suffering and destruction can emerge something new, a new earth with the mark of God upon it. We believe our efforts make a difference and transforms hope into bread for the hungry, clothes for the poor, and love for the forgotten. We believe the church is a community of hope, living the love of Jesus for all creation, continually renewed by the fresh winds of the Spirit.
Let us continue our worship by presenting our tithes, our gifts, and our offerings.
Myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be. Cloudy, there is still a light that shines on me. till tomorrow, let it be.
Wake up to the sound of music. Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be.
Generous God, we can never repay you for your loving kindness to us or for the gift of your Son Jesus to be our Savior. But we ask that you would receive these gifts we bring to continue your mission of love both in our church and beyond our doors. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. As we come to our time of prayer, I'd like to let you know some of the concerns of our church family and friends. We are praying for Jack Young, Vi Hanna, David McCann, Tracy Herring, Ken Heck, Patricia Zappone, Cynthia Mario, Marilyn, Judy, Ian, another Judy, Fran, Richard, Ray, who's on hospice, Tim, and Chrissy Roche's sister, Dawn. We're praying for Joan Carey, Cindy, Vince, Pat, Kathy McLaughlin, Marge, Karen, Susan Ritchie, Linda, Cliff Barr, Kay, John, and Tristan. We are also keeping in our prayers and sending sympathies to Wendy Lowe's. She lost her mother this week. And so we want to send her our prayers and our thoughts and reach out to her at this sad time. Are there any other joys or concerns to share? Yes?
My grandson, Ron.
Oh, goodness. Okay. Lynn's grandson, Ron. Then let's join our hearts and minds in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and glorious God, we come to you this morning rejoicing in your power and love that raised Jesus from the dead. You have set us free to love and serve you in this world, and you have breathed the Holy Spirit to us to empower us as we live our lives as a reflection of your great love. And so, Lord Jesus, be with us as we worship you here this morning. Dispel any darkness or doubt with the bright light of your presence. Help us to trust in you and in the power of your love. Lord our God, we pray that we may see you through eyes of faith, that in seeing you we may begin to know you, and in knowing you we will give ourselves in love to serve others. We pray this morning that you will bless our church here in Margate. We thank you again for those who have answered the Spirit's call to serve this church with their various talents and gifts. We thank you for all members of our church family who gather to worship you and serve you. Grant us your wisdom and vision that we may grow in grace and love in this community. This morning, Lord, we also pray for our world, for all in authority, that they may be just and wise in their dealings, so that all of us may work for peace on this planet. We have mentioned our concerns before you, O Lord, and we pray now in silence for the concerns that lie deeply in our hearts. Hear us, good Lord. We pray all these things in the strong name of Jesus, who taught us all to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our final hymn is found in the bulletin. I have decided to follow Jesus. Us for coffee hour after the service, and that you will go this week and make each day count. And may the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship, strength, and peace of the Holy Spirit be with you and with all those whom you love today and forever. Amen.
No turning back, no turning back.
Well, it was easier at night.